So now we go from looking at the external ecosystem to having a look at the internal ecosystem. Inside your organization, you've got multiple teams. They're each responsible for different parts of your technology landscape, and increasingly, companies are turning to microservices as a way of helping to manage and give teams the autonomy to look after their own microservices. But the challenge, which Archana and Pooja are going to address, is how to make that scale. So please, Pooja and Archana, welcome.
Thank you, John. Thanks for the great introduction. So, like you said, we're probably changing gears a little bit and focusing on what sort of microservices we built in the past and how we can leverage some learnings that we have had from our experience. And we sort of wanted to distill that into 10 commandments. But before I start, maybe I'll give a quick introduction. So I'm Archana. I'm a lead engineer at BCG Digital Ventures. I've been working with microservices for the last 5, 6 years. So I've had a lot of battle scars while building these out. Pooja.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. I'm Pooja. I'm a lead developer at ThoughtWorks. Like Archana, I've also worked with a lot of clients, helping them in their digital transformation journey. So today, hopefully, we'll share some of our learnings.
Thanks, Pooja. So we'll jump right in. And so we have put this together in the order of things that we think sort of fall into a natural sequence of things when you start building microservices. So the first one that we have here is to make sure that you stick to your service boundaries. So when we talk about microservices, obviously, you'd do some form of domain-driven design to come up with your service boundaries. Whether it's a brand new platform that you're building, where the microservices are built from scratch, or you are doing some sort of legacy transformation and moving your monolith into microservices, this is one of the first things you would do to carve out your service boundaries. But the problem usually comes in when your services start expanding and you start growing the number of services that you have. So when you move from 10, 20 services you have to 40, 50, or even hundreds of microservices, then there is a problem where your boundaries sort of start blurring. And so at that point, it's really important to remember that each service owns its own data store, and it's not a great idea to share these data stores with any service outside of its service boundary. And when the data has to be shared, it is advocated to share this data in the form of well-defined APIs instead of directly giving your consumers access to your data store. So, for example, if you consider an e-commerce ecosystem where you have an order service or a payment service, your payment service will definitely need to get details from the order service, but instead of allowing this data to be accessed directly, you expose it via APIs. So in one of the projects that I was on, our tech lead kind of wanted to create a library of data models. So order service will have a data model library, which could then be shared outside with other services so they can consume this data easily. But this is not such a great idea in retrospect. It's an anti-pattern because the moment you start doing this, it becomes really hard to change your schema. So if you have shared your data model for your order service outside to payment service, for example, then changing your schema is going to be very dependent on your external consumers as well. And then as the number of services grow, this problem just goes outside your control. So that is our first advice for you to stick to your service boundaries.
Just a quick thing. I don't think I'm able to see the screen.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. Hi. Is that okay now? No?
Not yet.
Okay. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Pooja. So sorry about that. But this is the great slide you were supposed to be looking at with all the service boundaries. But I guess I'll just move on to the next one. So the next thing that we have for you is to make sure to expose your APIs via gateways. So I'm sure this has become a common practice these days to expose all the APIs via gateways. And APIs are great places to have certain common logic embedded in, like the traditional ones that you would go after are routing and rate limiting, so that you can unify the way you provide access to your APIs to your external consumers. So this could be to web apps, to mobile apps, even third parties who are going to consume your API as a product. The gateway provides a unified interface to allow this to be accessed. But there's also a flip side to this, that is to ensure that you do not overload your API with a lot of business logic, because this then becomes really hard to test and hard to maintain. And in a scenario that I described previously, where the number of services explored, this problem just becomes extra hard to manage. The other thing that you could do in a microservice ecosystem is to leverage a service mesh, especially if you're using a container orchestration system like Kubernetes. You can think about leveraging your service mesh to act as a proxy or as a sidecar to your service and keep the application logic light within your services. So again, this is very contextual, and what percentage of the logic goes into your service mesh or into your application is up to you to decide. So there have been arguments to having logging, request logging, response logging part of your sidecar, or it could be part of your application as well. So it's important to consider the pros and cons and choose an approach that makes sense to you. The next thing is choosing the right communication protocol. So we've spoken about APIs, and when we talk about APIs, we naturally think of, perhaps not so much anymore, but usually we think of REST APIs with maybe JSON requests and responses, but this may not be the right fit in all cases. So it is really important to think about who is going to consume your APIs and what is the sort of experience that user is looking at before deciding what sort of communication protocol you want your APIs to stick to. So the decision points could be, does this have to be a synchronous API or an asynchronous API? And again, there are pros and cons for both. So for example, if you're thinking of something like a payment operation where your client is waiting for the payment to be completed, then it makes sense for it to be synchronous, because the entire transaction then sort of falls within the boundary of a synchronous call. But there could be other reasons why you would want something to be asynchronous. So one example I can think of is in one of the applications we were building, we needed to allow admin users to upload large Excel files which contained a lot of user data, and these users will then get onboarded into the platform. So in an operation like that, this process of onboarding a user actually encompassed three or four microservices, and so there was more sense for this to be an asynchronous process. But again, when you go with an asynchronous solution, you will have to make sure to think about error handling and rollbacks in case something goes wrong. So in the example that I just mentioned, when the onboarding happens and the call actually fails across services, you have to make sure that the other services go back and do a rollback or do some other form of error handling so that the operation is not stranded midway. There are other considerations as well. So usually when we say REST, it goes hand in hand with JSON, and then the other option is to use gRPC in your API calls, and gRPC kind of goes hand in hand with protobufs. So again, there's pros and cons. So JSON REST is fairly standard. Most external consumers will have the right tools and processes in place to consume this. But gRPC and protobuf give like a more succinct way of expressing your API contracts. You don't have to manually create libraries for contracts to be consumed by your clients anymore. They can be automatically created. But then when you use protobufs, you have to make sure that there is like a strict discipline and convention when the schema grows, that there is some strict discipline in place so that it doesn't become too unwieldy to handle. So again, our recommendation here is to choose the right protocol based on what your use case is and what makes sense for that. The next one that we're going to talk about is versioning your APIs. This is also really important, especially if you think of use cases where the APIs are used by a mobile client, for example, and it's in production. Then versioning your APIs becomes really important, because when you release new features, not all your front-end users will upgrade their apps at the same time. So you might have to support one or more version of your API so that all the users who are using different versions of your mobile app can experience the application seamlessly. So in order to do this, things that you have to remember is you have to maintain backward compatibility, at least to a certain number of versions. You have to follow standards practices to say all breaking changes will have major version number changes, all minor changes will have minor version changes. So non-breaking changes will have minor version number changes and so on and so forth. But again, there is a flip side to this, as always, that is, if you have too many versions of APIs available, then it becomes harder to support it and to maintain it across versions. So you have to remember to decommission these APIs appropriately when nobody's using them or when only a small number of users are using them. And what we have on the diagram there is two ways to version your API. So you can have one service expose both version of your APIs, or you can have a separate service instance for each version. So you could choose whichever option works for you, but one has application complexity, the other has complexity in terms of deployment and infrastructure. But whichever approach you choose, you have to make sure to follow a consistent strategy across all services in your ecosystem. And then we obviously have to talk about performance, because now we have some standards in place and our APIs are exposed. I'm sure we've all faced a situation in our life where our systems are down and there's not too much we can do about it because it is caused by an event outside our control. So maybe there's a 9.9 sale or a 10.10 sale and there are a lot of users using the application and you are maintaining a service which is providing user's birth date, so something like that, some information that you did not think it was very relevant until today, when with the increased number of users, your service crashed. But that's the beauty of microservices, which is it lets you scale your services in different ways based on the kind of load that you can foresee, right? So maybe a way to do that is to cache data where you pre-work or pre-compute as much as possible and you cache that data. Or another option is to cache data that does not change very often, cache it so that there's lesser chance of it being stale. Another option is to optimize your service so that you can have like an instance of your service for read-heavy operations and one for write-heavy operations. Then other common patterns that we can do is leveraging parallelism or asynchronous calls, or like I said, you use the service mesh for load balancing and scaling. So these are some examples, but based on your use case, you can use one or two or a combination of these options to make your services very performant. But even if you do that, there are chances that your service will crash. And at that point, you need to know how to recover from a failure. And unfortunately for us, we are all not like Chuck Norris, so we can't like stare our code into submission. So this is when observability comes into play. And for this, I'll hand over to Pooja to talk more about this.
Thanks, Archana. So a key metric for any application is the turnaround time to do a root cause analysis for a production issue. So in a distributed ecosystem where there are multiple microservices which interact with each other, it just becomes impossible to identify the problem by just manually trying to reproduce the issue in lower environments, because there could be multiple things that have caused the said issue, right? This is why observability becomes all the more critical in such applications. Archana, can you move on to the next slide? Yeah. So another one for, sorry. Yeah, so what we've tried to depict here is one way to think about building up your application's observability maturity. The base of it all is to have a proper logging, telemetry, and health checks for each of your services. So when I say proper, I mean ensuring logs are at the right levels so that you can differentiate between a successful transaction and a failure, and having a consistent log structure for all of your services, defining log rotation strategies, etc. Another aspect to keep in mind is to ensure the traceability of your requests. And how do you, for example, know that a request arriving at a payment service correlates to a corresponding request in an order service? You would have to have mechanisms such as correlation ID, request response traces in place so that you can keep track of requests that are spanning multiple microservices. Adhering to these logging principles, these are quite important because this is what will help you in your aggregations and profiling that eventually drive monitoring and alerting capabilities. So you would have like a centralized dashboard based off your logs that will display different metrics like error rates or any other business metrics. For example, in one of the e-commerce clients that I work for, we use these dashboards to report a number of successful order placements, the number of failed orders, conversion rates from cart to an order, etc. And these were some of the key drivers that the business used to add new features or modify the existing features as the users require. One of the most popular pattern here is to use the ELK stack because it gives you the ability to query, analyze, and visualize your logs. The next aspect that I wanted to quickly highlight is testing. So most of you would already be aware of the test pyramid, right? It's not very different in the microservices world. It probably just has one or two more steps in between. That's what I'll cover today. The first layer is the integration testing layer. What you typically would do here is to test all the integration points that your code has, be it an integration with a database or an external service. What I'd like to highlight here is the service virtualization technique. So if you're testing a particular service that is dependent on another service, you potentially mock out that service and return dummy data to the service that you're testing. So for example, if you're testing something in an order service, which is dependent on data from an inventory service for, let's say, an inventory data, you would typically stub out the inventory data so that you can test out the core functionality of the order service itself. This ensures that your order service doesn't fail for a reason that is not because of the order service. So any downstream dependencies can thus be mocked, and your service tests become more predictable because your fail test would be a result of a failure of that particular service and nothing else. Now, the question that might arise here is, if you're mocking the external service, then how do you test the entire interaction between the two and ensure that there's no failure and the integrity is maintained? This is where contract testing comes into play. So consumer-driven contract testing is a way by which consumers of your services or your APIs will hold the service or API provider accountable to sticking to a contract definition. So if there's any deviation in terms of any URL change or request response changes, these automated contract tests will fail. And that'll help you catch any failures earlier on in your cycle. So PACT and Spring Cloud contracts are some of the examples of consumer-driven contract testing frameworks that you could integrate with. So now that we've covered this, let's move on to the next commandment, which is probably the least favorite for developers, that's documentation. What do you folks think is the most difficult part of documenting? You probably leave your thoughts in the chat. So for me, the most challenging thing is to keep the documentation up to date. Now, your application and ecosystem is so dynamic that if you don't spend dedicated time in maintaining this documentation, it's bound to become outdated very soon. So one of the ways that I've personally found very effective for documenting code is by writing good tests. Tests evolve organically with code, hence there's no additional maintenance overhead that you need to think about. And the only thing that you need to ensure is to have descriptive tests that cover different scenarios as applicable for your functionalities. Secondly, if you're exposing APIs as a product to multiple consumers, you could integrate it with a tool like Swagger, which to some extent automates your API contract definitions, and this will serve as a documentation for your consumers. And of course, if you're building an application with a lot of moving parts, it does become very critical to document key architectural decisions so that there's traceability in times as to why a certain decision was taken at a given point in time. Because it sort of serves as an audit trail for all of the architectural decisions that were made. Okay, so now we've built robust, scalable services that are well-tested and documented, but that's not enough, right? One of the biggest cross-cutting concern for every application is security. As you see in the diagram here, security needs to be addressed in every layer, right? From the database to the code that you're writing in the services to the infrastructure that's hosting the services. So it's quite evident to say that security cannot be an afterthought. Like for example, you can't say, okay, I've coded this functionality. Now let me go back and look at the code and see if it's secure enough. Because it's just unnecessary complexity, right? So it's important that you bake in security right from the start of the development. What we've provided here are just some of the measures that you could take to secure your application. For example, ensure TLS to secure any communication with your APIs, especially the external consumers. Secondly, authenticate and authorize every request using a mechanism like identity tokens or access tokens. you need to think about security of any sensitive data, whether it's at rest in the database or it's in transit between services. And as Archana mentioned earlier, right, you can use API gateways to provide this additional layer of security. For example, rate limiting if you want to prevent any unwanted DDoS attacks. And the most important thing is to ensure that it's not just the application, but also your infrastructure and the supporting ecosystem is secure and has well-defined access control rules. These are just a handful of measures that we've mentioned here, and what you would take would depend on the kind of services that you are building, depending on the kind of system that you're building. So for example, if you're building a payment system, the security requirements are much more stringent, so you'll have to go through a lot more scrutiny compared to a normal system that you're building. What you could do is to have a threat modeling session that'll help you identify some of the areas of vulnerabilities within your system. And you could potentially take a look at what are the different ways in which you can protect your system against these vulnerabilities. The last thing that we would like to leave you with is to be careful about not ending up building a distributed monolith, right? That's only worse than having a monolith application. So as Archana mentioned at the start, you would apply some architectural principles like domain-driven design to identify the boundaries of your services. However, this is not just a one-time process, it's an evolving system, right? So as you add more functionalities, you would need to be careful that you don't end up building a distributed monolith. Some of the things, some common patterns that we've observed that you could keep in mind to see that you don't fall into this trap is to think about whether your services are independently deployable. Does a failure in one service cause a cascading failure in other services? Are your services independently scalable? If you see that some of these are becoming difficult, then you should it should raise an alarm bell, right? For example, in one of the projects that we worked on, the biggest trouble going to production was to coordinate releases between different service teams. So in order for one service to be able to go live, we had to coordinate functionalities with multiple different services. And then there was this huge release plan that we had to come up with. And it was pretty time consuming to go live for just one small functionality. If we were to talk about the other side of the spectrum, what we should also be careful about is to not make our services too micro. What this would create is a lot of chattiness between the services, because you'll have to keep interacting between services to get any small data. But what people usually end up doing is duplicate data across services so that this chattiness reduces. But that's also not a good way, right? You'll just end up having consistency issues between services, and then you'll have to talk about how do I maintain consistency. It just adds to the complexity as well. So I think it's a double-edged sword. You'll probably have to maintain and strike a balance between, hey, am I building a distributed monolith versus am I cutting it too short and creating too many microservices in our system? So just to sum it all up, I think these are the top 10 things in our opinion that you would have to keep in mind while working with services. Happy to take questions.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Archana and Pooja. I think there are lots of practical steps there that people can follow to help scale microservices. But I guess also you've indicated some of the trade-offs. So it's not as simple as just follow these 10 steps and everything will be fine. What struck me is that In each occasion, you have to decide how many microservices you want, and is that sustainable? And I certainly that comment you made about don't build a distributed monolith, I think is very apt. So thanks very much for sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So we're going to continue.